and we try to package. And if it detects a failure, it will warn the maintainer of the package that there is an issue with the scrape file. So when OpenStack is released, usually all the spec files of RTO are ready and working. And each time a DeLorean package a software, it will create a working RPM repository that some CI can contribute to do some additional tests. And this RPM repository can be called, in fact, the master RPM repository of RDO. But I won't enter too much into detail, so you can have a look to this nice blog post. And also, I want to introduce another tool that is called RDO PKG that we include in that RPM factory. This is a tool to help RDO packager because it automates some common tasks of a packager, like bumping a spec file when you want to target a new type of upstream sources, or when you want to flatten the chain of patches in your spec file. In this RPM factory, we also wanted to integrate with Koji, but especially with CentOS, because CentOS is used to build and store stable releases of RDO. So, again, I won't enter into the detail of Koji and CentOS because in the previous presentation, we had a good presentation of it, so, but just as a quick reminder, Koji is a server to build RPM and also store RPM and and you can also manage RPM distribution with Koji. And the last tool we have included in this RPM factory is called Software Factory. So Software Factory is a platform with the same spirit, based on the same spirit of the upstream platform that allow OpenStack developers to do their work, to develop OpenStack. So we have included the same component into it. So we have first a Gerrit that is a Git hosting platform, and also a code review system. We have included also a CI component, so Jenkins, that is a job runner, and Zool, that is a job scheduler. So just a few words about Zool, because Zool is really an interesting component. So Zool is a component that has been developed by the OpenStack community to solve the problem of interdependent software. So in OpenStack, you have a lot of components that depend on each other. So when you want to test them, you need to take in account this fact. And Zool allows you to do that because you can define dependencies between patches on different Git repositories, on different components. So if we take a simple example, that is the example of a client and a server. If you want to implement a new feature, you have two repositories, one for the server, one for the client. And if you want to implement a new feature, usually you will have to do a patch on your server and another patch on the client. And when you want to test the client, you want in your test environment have also the patch for the server, to have both patches in your test environment. And Zool will manage that for you. It will tell Jenkins how to prepare the job environment to test this dependent project. We also have included a node pool that also has been developed by the OpenStack community. So node pool will manage a pool of Jenkins slaves, and each changes you propose on Gerrit will be automatically tested inside the slave created by node pool. And so slave created by node pool are created on OpenStack that are virtual machines, and are spawned based on the same snapshots. So all the slaves are the same with the same set of packages. And this is really important because you won't have side effects when you call job, like false negative. And we can compare that with a usual usually when you have Jenkins, you have long-running slave, and slave can be altered by other jobs, and this can sometimes create a false negative, so you can't be confident with your test platform. But with NotCool, this is the case. Usually when you have an issue with a test, this is due to your code or the code of your test, but not an issue from the CI. And to come back a bit on Zool, we also take part of a really interesting feature of Zool that is a smart gating, where Zool is like the release manager of your software. So when a patch is approved on Git, it will automatically rebase the patch on the master branch of the Git repository and run the test on this rebased patch. And only if the test passed, it will launch the patch on the master branch. So with that, you can ensure that your master branch is always working. At least your master branch always passed your test suite. So this is really important. And there is a lot of stuff to say about Zool. This is a complex and really powerful system. So I wrote a blog post about it, so I don't have the link here, but you can easily find it on internet. This is called Dive into Zool. So you can have a look. This is really interesting. And to finish on Software Factory, Software Factory is like community driven, so each part you want to configure inside Software Factory, like you want to store a new project, you want to add someone in a project group, you want to define a new job, you want to define how a job is triggered. All of that configuration can be done via a Git repository that is called the config repository. And each change that is proposed in the config can be reviewed by the community of users of Software Factory. And when accepted, the patch on the configuration will be automatically applied by Software Factory itself. So you have nothing to do. Just define the configuration and accept the configuration via code review. And again, as this is a community driven, this is Software Factory offers really a flexible workflow, and you can do almost what you want with it. So this is also part of this Open Factory, used by the Arduino community. So we succeed to build it. The platform is accessible at review.rdoproject.org. So Arduino use it to build Arduino. Inside this platform, we have a Software Factory deployment. As I said, this is a standard Software Factory deployment, just branded for Arduino. All these Git repositories of RDO are hosted on the Git of the platform. We have, in parallel, we have a DeLorean server that continues to try to package upstream changes of OpenStack. Each time we need to update the this Git file, the this Git repository, so a spec file, we do that via Git and we pass through code review and CI testing through Zool, Jenkins, and NotCool. And if we target stable branches of RDO, we also build against CPS automatically. So I will be quick on this schema. This is all the components involved in the RDO workflow, but basically what you have to know is that we have three sources of data. So the first one is the upstream repository of OpenStack. After we have the DISKit repositories hosted on review.rdoproject.org. And repositories also hosted on review.rdoproject.org to store chain of patches. We have a strategy to manage chain of patches you have to include in, you may have to include in the spec file to keep history things together. So. But again, I won't enter into detail because I have so much time. So. So I will give the talk to Ekel to talk about the workflow.
Thanks, Fabien. Okay, so this part of the talk is more about the CloudSIG perspective. So I will explain the use cases that we have to manage. And the first one is packaging master changes, because OpenStack is a fast-paced project with multiple components that interact with each other. So one change in a component may break the other. You also have sometimes changes in upstream project that may break the packaging, like, oh, we removed some binary, or we moved things around, and it's quite often, it's kind of a mess. So we retrieve at every, well, almost any common change from upstream, and then we try to rebuild the packages from the existing spec. And then we build the package. So there are two cases that succeed. So everything is working. We're having this in CI. All good. Sometimes we have both failures. So that's the interesting part. The first thing is that when we have both failures, we create a placeholder review on Radio Garrett's that will help us to notify the maintainers, hey, this change upstream is breaking your packaging. We, in the review, you have a link to the potential upstream patch that is breaking things. Well, we're not building for every commit because it's too fast, but it's done at a very regular pace, so most of the time it may be that patch or a patch before, but at least it's a good hint. Then we have the logs from the building, so that helps you to identify the issue. And it creates another corresponding repository, because we're not just tracking upstream master branch, we're also tracking upstream stable branch. That's also the same workflow. So maintainers are automatically set as reviewer in Garrett. That doesn't mean that the maintainers will be the people fixing it, but at least they will be notified. So if anyone who wants to fix it, try to give it a shot, at least reviewers and maintainers will be happy to help him. And also, we're trying to have a meaningful review. So the placeholder review is supposed to fail. If it succeeds, that means that the build failure was a false positive. It happens sometimes, but it's quite rare nowadays. But at least you know that it's failing, and you have been able to reproduce the failure, which is super important. And that's a good thing. So another use case is also packaging the stable releases. So that part is more about lowering the entry barrier for new contributors. If you've been packaging for any Linux distribution, like CentOS, Fedora, Debian, the learning curve is quite difficult, because you have to learn about packaging, you have to learn about the build system and specifics, you have to be trusted by the existing packagers, so it takes time. So with this model, anyone can open a review, but you don't need any access to the build system. And this review will run some sanity checks, like is it balding in the build root? Is it passing CI? Okay, and then you just have to convince maintainers to vote for your review. Okay, this patch is okay, so let's give it a try. And sometimes it can take 5 minutes to get your first patch accepted in Radio, and that's quite a success, I think. but more on the community side. On the technical side, every time we have a change, we have a scratch board on CDS. Scratch boards are just like, hey, we want to have a board in the board system just to check that it works in the board system, because board system has specifics, like the board root has no network access, so if your package at board time tries to download stuff from the internet, it will fail. And that's not something that you may identify when you are trying packaging on your local laptop. CI will be run, so it can score, plus one, minus one. And you have to have a plus one to, plus two on from CI to get your patch merged. So patch are merged automatically by Garrett, according to those. You have a link to the CBS board blogs on the review page, so you can also check the failure and send why it fails. And the artifact, like RPMI fetch from CPS and on the CI system to be tested. So, if it's CI, CD, in case of those systems, then the artifacts are generated on CES. I couldn't find this a bit inexact on this part. So we launch a real board on CES. The change is merged and the review fails. The artifacts are discarded, and then you got minus two on your review from CI, and the patch is not merged. But you can iterate to improve it, or just embed it if it's not useful. Another use case are distro-specific patches. Sometimes packaging guidelines may change, or you identified some packaging issues you want to fix. So you just do your changes on the diskette, and it will also trigger build. You don't have to wait change on upstream sources to have a new build. You also have sometimes some distro-specific patches. So in the case of RDO, we're trying to have the less patches as possible in our packaging. The few patches we have currently for Newton are mostly one or two patches on the clients, the libraries, for some build issues. It's one or two something. And the other one are customization patches for the dashboard. And I think it's something that we are discarding. So you also have a different repo that is holding patches, so it's a mirror of upstream sources. And on top of upstream sources, you have your own patches that are rebased. And the thing is, the patches are not merged in the patches repo. So we keep open reviews. The Erzing packaging will handle the specifics for you, but this way, using Garrett, we can store the history of patch. So every time you rebase your patch, it gets rebased, but Garrett will store the history. You can, for instance, let's say the rebase failed at some point, you can retrieve the original patch from Garrett and rebase it yourself to fix it and push it. So you don't lose any information, right? Which is super important when you manage a long-lived patch. But in case of RDO, we're trying to not have long-lived patch, but sometimes it may happen. So the same, everything goes to our central board system. So the advantages from using the review workflows are, rebasing is easy. You're using Git, you're using Garrett for the history. We have the history of the patch. Quality is ensured because we have CI jobs checking patch, rebase patch or new patch. We are getting things more easily when we have multiple pager. For instance, I'm a federal pager for a long time, and when you have multiple people working on a package with patches, it's a mess. For instance, I use Git for managing patches, but my fellow packager are using just manual patches, and every time you have, you end up with a weird mixture of get-managed batch and not get-managed batch and it's a mess. So with this, we are ensuring that everyone are using the same tool. So it makes collaborative work more easy. So return on experience. So for the Newton cycle, which is the Pluto cycle, we're currently in the Oketa cycle. We had 800 comments, about 70 contributors. To give you an idea, my team, which is already engineering at Vedat, is about 8 people, and not all of them are doing pair. So that gives you an idea of how many external contributors we have from outside the RDO team. And we had a good feedback on this workflow because it's very easy. For OpenStack developers, it's pretty much the same workflow as Bear, the one they have upstream. For people not used to Garrett, it's quite easy. It's much easier than the workflow we used to have. It also helped us to detect more fastly patching issue. We had about 230 bug failures. So in a cycle, that's about one failure and a half per day. Well, we don't have any failures every day, but sometimes you get 20 or 30 failures on the same day. More generally before releases, so, well, you get a lot of work at this time. Also, by detecting the failure early, it helped us to have Newton contagions. Well, it says 24 hours. I was the one doing the Newton release. From upstream release announcement to RDO general availability, it took 10 hours. And in 4 hours, we had everything ready. Artifacts, all tested. Everything was just working. And we had platform issues at the same time. So we're trying to, next time, to get under these 4 hours. And I know it's recorded. So if you are a SIG or you want to reproduce this setup outside CentOS or something, you can. Because all of these tools are open source available. The Marin is, which is a part doing the build, is available, is generally not used for non-Python projects. OpenStack is in Python, by the way. We're starting to use this for a few Go projects. I know that we have network people looking at using it for C and C++ projects. The OpenDelight project is looking at it. OpenDelight is network function virtualization umbrella project, most of them written in Java. So they are also looking at using it. So it should be working for any kind of project. And if it's not working for your project, we're happy to hear from you about it. We'll fix it. It helps you define a full European test suite. Installation, remove the grading, smoke testing, in conjunction with Software Factory. We can also have integration case between multiple RPM. You have multiple examples like client-server architecture or complex system like OpenStack, which are not just client servers, but multiple clients, multiple servers, all interacting with each other. And in this case, Zoo has been very helpful to define us very complex CI pipelines. And also, the part interesting for 6, automating package building in CBS without granting full access to the build system to all your contributors. The thing is, most of the new contributors have no experience, that's why they're new contributors. So to avoid mistakes, you prefer that all the building, the tagging is done automatically. And even from an experienced packager point of view, I prefer that I'm not the one launching all the builds. I prefer having all my changes reviewed, tested, and then just send to the bolt system and get everything done for myself. So it's even less work for us. And well, if you to give you a comparison to GitHub workflow, using Gerrit for code review has advantages. I won't go through that. The slides will be made available, and this needs to link to an article with a lot of details. But you get to integrate your CI in your reviewing system, and that's the important part for myself. And you see other things. So, from a community point of view, well, that's transparency of the process. We don't have a secret sauce. We're trying to remove all the secret sauce. So you can see how we are doing our work. You can start working in 5 minutes. We have a few blog posts explaining how to send a patch, how the system is working. So in 5 minutes, you should be able to send your first patch to IDEO. You also get peer review, which is something that is very difficult in the distribution landscape. For instance, in Fedora, we've been discussing this for nearly a decade, and we have almost nothing yet. It also allows faster onboarding. We have people who are not used to packaging doing now packaging. We have people doing packaging in other distribution that can do packaging. We have upstream developers who don't want to deal with packaging, but well, want to make sure that things are getting packaging review, but are helping us. So this is working, and it's kind of successful. So we'll give the mic to Mathieu back.
I would just if you want to conclude. Right now, there are a few open source projects that are using this workflow. So either just as a factory there, because they are not, they don't really necessarily have packaging problematics, or they do them themselves. So obviously, Sorta Factory is being developed on Sorta Factory. A few projects also that are related to OpenStack, so the Circuit CI, which is as a nice, but it's Circuit CI. And Skydive, there will be a presentation about Skydive in the afternoon, so I don't have to talk too much about it. It's a network analyzer in the runtime. And also, obviously, on review.erdio.com, we have the projects that are more interested in focused on packaging, like Erdio, DeLorean, and also Obstools that joined the platform recently. And obviously, as we mentioned, everything is language agnostic, so that means even though we work mostly on Python, you can use it with anything. For instance, Skylight is coded in Go, I think. Yeah, that's it. So yeah, all you have to do is to define your workflow, how you want your code to be validated, the amount of verification, the test you want to do. You define all your test suits, also your test environment. All of this is versioned, because it's managed by code, like we said. And it's very easy to deploy, because provide a Sorta Factory as an image, but you go to an image. So if you have an OpenStack cloud, or even you can run it on locally on the system. So you can have your own instance. So that's it for this presentation. Thank you for staying with us. And if you have any questions, of course you can ask them now. We're going to be all day at the dojo. Or if you're interested in seeing how you can set up your instance for your own thing, or if you're interested in starting your own thing with a brand new instance, Sorta Factory or something similar to what Apple has, then you can join us also. Thank you.
By the way, for instance, you had experience because the OpsTools seed was incubated within the council, so feel free to come talk with us if you want to help. We would really be happy to.
Of course, but it's just 11, so if you have questions, we can talk now with the presenters. Yeah?
Yeah, so,
yes,
I mean, no?
Yeah.
Because the software factory was based on the previous version of the factory, just on their platform, now it doesn't support anything anymore. So, what's the roadmap for the software factory?
for, right?
Yes, we try to follow what
the only problem we have right now is that Zool, so I guess you're aware of the way Zool is progressing, and the Zool V3 is in the work at the moment. And the few things that we need at the moment are not available in Zool, in the current Zool version. Mainly the credentials management that we have in Jenkins. And it's really because we do some continuous deployment as well, and continuous delivery, and we need to have credentials being managed. The way the OpenStack does it at the moment is that they store the credentials on the VMs where they run the deployment, which we don't think it's a good idea. We prefer to do it manage it with the Jenkins credential printing. But the V3 will include a way to store credentials. So we are waiting for the V3 to be available. And,
this part is so that the lower-end parts. So the good thing with OpenStack is that most components have a pretty more standard versioning. Not all of them, but most of them. So we managed to fit that into the RPM NVR conventions, and also ensure that the upgrades work. So the thing is, at some point we just try to use a checksum in the release field. So we use now the standard OpenStack versioning from a set of tools. Then we take the versioning. We also take we have a database in Delorean to have the full history of both. So we ensure that it is increased. So every time you take a batch about Delorean, you get a checksum to map it to upstream sources, and then you have some numbering magic to make sure that it upgrades. But
yeah, but the problem is if you do like a more generic level, if I do a continuous integration with RPMs for any kind of project, so I would really like to have a generic approach to the problem, okay. not just open like that. Maybe some RPM markers will be used a bit tag or something, because
By default it would work. The thing is, for the version part of the RPM, we're using a set of tools. But the release is generated by Delorean, so it ensures that the package are always upgraded. But for the version field, by default it will be 0.0.1. But that's the part that would need to be changed. And it's managed by shell script, but that's something that we could put in the library, so you can just hook a script to retrieve a version from sources. For instance, if you use AutoTools, the version is stored somewhere in AutoTools Magic. So you can say, okay, just read that file, retrieve the version number, and then use it for the RPM. Or if your project has no proper versioning, you can handle some magic to do that for you. Any other question? Okay, so I'm giving you back some of your time, and see you later.